Today we'll discuss bone development and growth. Recall that bones are constructed of two types of bone tissue, compact bone and spongy or trabecular bone. Compact bone comprises the outer wall of mature bone, while the inner layer or marrow cavity consists of the more porous bone, the trabecular or spongy or cancellous bone. Importantly, and as we discussed in the first video, all adult bone has the same histological structure. Bone formation begins early in embryogenesis and it develops by two processes. Osteoblasts can secrete osteoid directly into portions of the condensed mesenchymal connective tissue, and this is called intramembranous ossification. Alternatively, cartilage models of bone are elaborated by chondroblasts in condensed mesenchyme, which is then replaced by bone, and this is termed endochondral ossification. But in both of these cases, bone is made in the same order. Osteoblasts will produce two arrangements of collagen fibers. First, they will deposit random arrays of fibers. This is now primary or woven bone, a temporary bone that will be removed or replaced with secondary bone. Secondary bone, or lamellar bone, consists of parallel collagen fibers that are arranged in layers. It can be permanent but will still be remodeled. Now remember that both compact or cortical bone, which is thick bone with osteons, and trabecular bone are composed of secondary bone. Again, all secondary bone is lamellar, whether it's compact or trabecular. So let's look a bit more at this organization. Let's start with primary or woven bone. Here in the cartoon on the left, you can see the random oriented collagen fibers. This bone appears during embryogenesis and repair and always looks trabecular, and remember that it's temporary. It's also a relatively quick process. The cartoon on the right depicts the collagen fibers now in parallel to one another, but oriented 90 degrees from fibers in the adjacent layer, or lamellae. In compact bone, these fibers are in the cylindrical lamellae of osteons. In trabecular or spongy bone, the lamellae run length of the trabeculae with the fibers still in a parallel orientation. And this arrangement allows for greater strength and less fragility. Think about the differences between a piece of plywood versus a thin sheet of balsa wood. Failure to remodel primary to secondary bone can lead to more fragile bones and can increase the number of fractures. A cancer called osteosarcoma, osteo for bone, or sarcoma, a tumor from connective tissue, can arise from osteoprogenitor cells, and these tumors are characterized by production of disorganized woven bone from mesenchyme. Not surprisingly then, these tumors are often first detected by fractures at the site of the tumor. Now let's take a look at the two processes of bone development. Intramembranous ossification is the formation of bone in mesenchymal tissue, and it's responsible for the development of the flat bones of the skull and the mandible. Primary bone is formed in discontinuous patches that are separated by connective tissue, shown here in yellow. As these patches expand, they will merge, and some of these islands of connective tissue will remain to become the Haversian canals of forming osteons in compact bone. Here is an H&E stained section of a developing mandible where you can see the islands of bone developing amid the connective tissue. Also recognizable here is a developing tooth. Intramembranous ossification is critical for long bone growth as well, initiating bone formation in the perichondrium in the middle of the presumptive diaphysis, forming a bone collar. And this process is also responsible for the expansion in width or appositional growth of long bones. Here are two more images of intramembranous ossification. And you can note the position of the osteoblasts on the endosteum, osteoblasts that will arise from osteoprogenitor cells in the mesenchyme. Endochondral ossification requires the elaboration of a cartilage model that occurs in condensed mesenchyme, a model that is replaced by bone. Once the bone collar is formed by intramembranous ossification, the underlying chondrocytes are programmed to hypertrophy, deposit calcium phosphate into the matrix, and then die. An osteoblast will cover the shaft in a thin layer of bone, and blood vessels will penetrate the bone collar through the actions of osteoclasts, and the osteoprogenitor cells will enter. They will produce osteoblasts, which will deposit osteoid on the calcified cartilage matrix, creating primary bone. This is the primary ossification center. Now recall that these bones will expand in width, by appositional growth as osteoblasts add material to an outer surface through intramembranous ossification. But also to increase diameter and maintain the marrow space, osteoclasts will begin removing bone from the inside. And this combination of addition and subtraction, or making and taking, is called modeling. After birth, blood vessels will invade the end of long bones, the epiphysis, creating a secondary ossification center. While a band of hyaline cartilage remains between the primary and secondary centers, and this band will serve to supply the cartilage matrix for ossification. The bones will increase in length until this plate of cartilage disappears. Now here's a second cartoon showing the enlargement of the secondary ossification center with the epiphyseal cartilage plate. The epiphyseal plate can be divided into recognizable zones that reflect the functions related to bone growth and development. Closest to the epiphyseal side is the zone of resting or reserve cartilage. These are the reserve of cells that will supply the other zones. Next, there is a zone where chondrocytes are actively proliferating. This is a very orderly process so that the cells will appear in long columns. These cells are active chondrocytes secreting components of hyaline cartilage, including type 2 collagen. Next, we have the zone of maturation or hypertrophy. In this zone, chondrocytes stop dividing, swell, and now secrete components that promote calcification. And one of these components is collagen 10, which is unique to developing or fractured bone. In the zone of calcification, chondrocytes will release substances that begin matrix calcification by forming hydroxyapatite crystals. And the chondrocytes will also die in this zone. And you can see that this zone contains darker staining spicules in the former cartilage matrix. In the zone of ossification, bone tissue appears. Here, capillaries and osteoprogenitor cells will invade the cavities where the chondrocytes have died. Osteoblasts will now settle in a layer over the spicules and secrete osteoid and form that woven or primary bone. And again, this bone will be remodeled later as lamellar bone. It's interesting to note that the epiphyseal plate doesn't get bigger as the bone grows because the proliferation and destruction slash calcification occurs equally. Pathologies then can occur where the bone matrix doesn't calcify normally, and thus the epiphyseal plate can become distorted by body weight and muscular activity. This can cause bones to grow more slowly, and often they become distorted. You should think about what deficiencies might lead to problems with calcifications. And then, what kind of predictions can you make about the radiographic and histological appearance of long bones and the epiphyseal plate in these types of patients? Bone growth will continue until closure of the epiphyseal plate, and this cartoon summarizes some of the factors or hormones that regulate endochondral ossification. For example, growth hormone or somatostatin from the anterior pituitary positively regulates chondrocyte proliferation, while fibroblast growth factor or FGF negatively regulates this proliferation. In achondroplasia, literally meaning without cartilage, overactivation of FGF signaling will prevent endochondral ossification, resulting in dwarfism. And since this doesn't affect intramembranous ossification, the bones will be short and thick. Late in adolescence, decreases in the production of growth hormone lead to reduced chondroblast proliferation, and all the growth plate cartilage will become bone. In contrast, overproduction of growth hormone can lead to acromegaly. Overproduction before growth plate closure leads to exaggerated height or gigantism, and overproduction after growth plate closure leads to progressively thicker bones in adults with very characteristic facial and hand features. The two growth processes I've just described are also important for repair of bone fractures. This is a developmental process which involves cartilage and osteogenic activity of bone cells. Briefly, fractures result in the rupture of blood vessels in the bone, followed by clot formation, which is soon invaded by myofibroblasts, chondroblasts, and osteoblasts. The periosteum and endosteum will proliferate, and osteoblasts will secrete a matrix that will bridge the gap temporarily. A callus will form that will eventually be replaced with primary bone by intramembranous and endochondral ossification. Over time, remodeling will occur that will replace the primary bone with secondary bone, and physical and mechanical stresses will help restore the normal structure of the bone.